Thank you for joining us for our conversation, Why Food Justice Matters. Today, we have four wonderful panelists, leaders, scholars, farmers, and organizers. They will be guiding us in a discussion centered on the power of knowledge, innovation, and community resiliency, all as a means of challenging the food system and advocating for a more equitable future. We invite you to add your voice to the discussion by using the hashtag Smithsonian Food. And I'd like to start today by asking each panelist to just briefly introduce themselves, your name and your organization, and also if you could share where you're joining us from today. So I'll start with you, Cheryse.
My name is Cheryse Kaui Sana, calling in from Lulule, Hawaii. I am a part of MAʻO Organic Farms, which is a nonprofit organization here in Lulule, and I am currently the farm manager.
Aloha, my name is Tiare, Toetuʻu-Aipa, and I am a current Haʻaoti intern here at MAʻO Organic Farms.
Thank you. And Dr. White?
Hi, my name is Monica White. I'm Associate Professor of Environmental Justice at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. I'm also the past board president of the Detroit Black Community Food Security Network. I'm also the author of Freedom Farmers, Agricultural Resistance. Freedom Farmers, Agricultural Resistance in the Black Freedom Movement.
Wonderful. And John?
Hi, I'm John Gray. I'm tapping in from occupied Lenape land of the Bronx. I'm a co-founder of Ghetto Gastro, which is a culinary collective born and bred in the Bronx, and we're focused on using food as a tool for liberation and storytelling.
Thank you so much, John. I'll share that I am probably 2 hours north of John in the Hudson Valley, also on occupied Lenape land. So we're in different places, but we have that in common. Thank you all so much for being here today. I wanted to start today by just defining some really important terms, terms that get tossed around, I think, in conversations like this one, and terms that I think tend to confuse a lot of people. And I imagine a lot of people listening today will be familiar with many of these terms, but some people might not be. So I thought to just get us on really like even footing, we could start with just some simple definitions. So I have four terms in mind. One is food justice, one is food sovereignty, one is food apartheid, especially as an alternative to a food desert. And the fourth is food access. So I thought I would assign one of these terms to each of you, and we can go in the order we just introduced ourselves. And I'd love for you to define exactly just how you think of that term when I just say it. So Cheryse, no pressure, but I'd love to start with you. How do you define food justice?
Food justice for me is being able to have control of in the decision making in the system of like how we access food. When I think of food justice, I think everyone has an equal part in making the decisions of how food is grown and the access, knowledge of the practices and who is growing the food. Just a quick thought just on what food justice means.
I think that's like one of the best definitions I've heard. Tiare, would you describe how you understand food sovereignty? How you describe that?
To me, I think food sovereignty is being able to take back our land. I look into where we can grow the things our ancestors grew. And being able to continue to practice it in our space.
Wonderful. Wonderful. And I'm looking forward to hearing, I feel like the work that both of you do, you embody food justice and food sovereignty. So I'm excited to hear more about it. Dr. White, would you be able to define food apartheid for us, especially in opposition to, or as an alternative to a food desert?
Sure. So food apartheid is a phrase that describes the structural inequities and the ways in which food is not equally distributed across communities and is often distributed on the basis of race, class, gender, nationality, all of the different kinds of social categories that we use to describe people. And so apartheid is when people talk about food deserts, I always say in quotes, that is, it sounds like it's something that's a natural occurring phenomena. And yet we also know that while folks often talk about Detroit as a food desert, in quotes, we know that a lot of food in the Midwest comes straight through Eastern Market and the Detroit River. And so it isn't that food isn't coming into the Detroit area, it's that we use different kinds of structural categories to decide who is actually worthy of access to nutrient-rich food, and what then are the ways that that food benefits those community members. And so I think that it's a way to sort of really target that this is a capitalist system that is established in such a way to disenfranchise folks from accessing nutrient-rich foods.
Thank you for explaining that. And I am just going to plug your book. I have my copy here, which just dives into the history of everything you just described with such detail and sort of brings it to life and makes it so undeniable. So we will definitely get into some more of the history soon, but thank you for that definition. And John, how do you describe food access? What comes to mind when I say that?
What comes to mind when you describe food access is what I don't have in my neighborhood. When I think about having or desiring fresh, nutrients-dense foods, I often have to leave my neighborhood. You know, I have to get on a bus, go to the city, drive up to Westchester. It's not really local. You know, like the doctor mentioned, the Bronx is the home to the largest food distribution center of its kind globally. So when you think about the second largest fish market to Tuskegee in Japan, a huge produce market, huge meat and dairy markets that supply a lot of like the Eastern Seaboard, their goods. And these neighborhoods that we live in are also inundated with the fossil fuel emissions. So you have asthma, then when we think about what's available in our supermarkets, which leads to diabetes and hypertension. So when I think of access, I think more about what I don't have at my fingertips than what I do have.
I appreciate you grounding it just immediately in where you are. I think that's really powerful. And yeah, I thank you all for those definitions. I feel like we're talking about so many things today. It's nice to start from this place of sort of shared understanding. And I think we're talking about things that I heard you all bring up include agency and worth and availability and, you know, these incredibly important things. So this is a conversation, no matter what you do in or outside of food, if you eat food, I think this is an important conversation today. Dr. White, I mentioned I wanted to kind of get into a little bit of history. And so beyond defining the terms that you all just collectively defined, I wanted to also kind of ground today's conversation in some legacy, specifically the legacy of the generative relationship between the land and Black and Indigenous communities. In your book, which I mentioned, you give so many examples that broaden the narrative from one that I would say is sort of singularly traumatic and painful to one that is a little bit more complicated and complex. And it includes just this vast history of knowledge and resilience and resistance and community building. And so my question for you is, I would love to hear you speak to why it's important to broaden and shift the narrative, and not only why it's important, but what we learn by doing so. What happens when we make things a little bit more complicated?
Thank you. I'm a follower of Chimamanda Adichie, and I think that we have often talked about Black people and our relationship to the land using a single story, right? The danger of the single story is that once you say African Americans and relationship to the land is one of slavery, tenant farming, and sharecropping, that sort of limits the kinds of questions that I hope to answer in Freedom Farmers. And so I thought, if slavery, tenant farming was all there was, especially given the work that was happening in Detroit, particularly with the Detroit Black Community Food Security Network, how then can we understand the ways in which African Americans at every economic downturn have turned to growing their own food? And so for me, it was important to offer a counter narrative, one that I saw in the members of the organization of D-Town, folks who are working at D-Town, and I didn't see the voices of the folks I was working with in Detroit represented in the scholarship. relationship. And so it is important to complicate those narratives, because when you talk about it in terms of a deficit model, what you tend to do is sort of talk about everything that's wrong, right? And so when I say a deficit model, that's like me coming into your home and saying, oh, thank you for the invitation. Well, that's wrong, and that's wrong, and that's wrong. This deficit model leads people to believe that there's nothing of value, opposed to an asset-based approach. This is how I approach my research. So I think that every community, absolutely every community, has something upon which to build. And so if we start with the question of what are the assets, that then leads us to a different kind of question. And it also honors those who have lived there, who have worked there, who have committed their time and attention in such a way that it gives us a different story. And so it's important that we have counter-narratives, because I think that when you have counter-narratives, you're then actually honoring those who do the work. You're honoring the legacies of those who have been committed to this work. And you really have a different kind of an analysis of, and even come up with different questions. So doing so offers us a wider range of options, a different way to understand what's happening. But more than anything else, I think it allows us, and which is what I hope to do in the book, to hold a mirror up in front of the faces of the centuries of Black folks who have worked the land, whose labor has not been respected and appreciated. And this is sort of a way that we can sort of honor the commitment of those who have done, who have provided food, and not just Black folks, right? And talking about the ways that food gets from seed to table, while recognizing all those who have touched the food and made it possible.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. I'm so appreciative of all the examples that you've described and shared in your book. You make it so clear that there's just a tremendous legacy. There are so many shoulders that so many people stand on. And not to put you kind of on the spot to do this, but I'm wondering if there's one person who kind of embodies everything you're saying. There's so many people, I know, but if there's one person that you wish more people listening today were familiar with, who's the first person to come to mind? And maybe you could tell us briefly their story.
Absolutely. It's her birthday. It's Fannie Lou Hamer. Mrs. Hamer.
It is her birthday.
Yes, it's her birthday. Yes. Mrs. Hamer. Ba-dum-bum, right? Thank you. So Mrs. Hamer is known for organizing, starting one of the founders of the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party. And we know her for slogans like sick and tired of being sick and tired. But we don't know. I think fewer people know about Freedom Farm Agricultural Cooperative. So Mrs. Hamer was a daughter of sharecroppers and was a sharecropper herself, committed many years in the field and had what we consider the sixth grade. Anyway, to me, what was valuable is while we talk about her having a sixth grade education, and we know during those days, a sixth grade education wasn't from September up until May. It was after the crops had been picked, probably like October, November. And then when the spring came, and so that was even shorter. And yet Mrs. Hamer was able to suggest, and she told us, that food had been used as a tool and instrument of oppression. Full stop. And so she then created Freedom Farm as a strategy to make sure that, one, people didn't have to leave the South in order to be able to provide for themselves housing and access to nutrient-rich food, healthcare, and all the kinds of things that we need. But I also think what's important about her story is the ways in which she saw providing food as a strategy toward liberation. So she said, don't leave the South. If you leave the South, everything comes from the land. And so she wanted people to stay in the South and to organize and to care for each other. And I think on her birthday, one of the most important things that I've learned about Mrs. Hamer, who was also part of the Southern cooperative movement of the late 60s and early 70s, wasn't just, do my children have enough to eat? Do I have housing? Do I have access to education and healthcare? But really, do we as a community? And then what do we need to do in order to make that happen?
I thank you so much for lifting up her name in this conversation. I think she's an American hero by all measures. And I appreciate the chance to speak about her on her birthday. I think her story and her life is just so vital. And honestly, I understand any nerves you might have, because to describe someone like that and do her justice is difficult, but I think you absolutely did. And I think thinking about her and her education and what she was able to offer and the way she was able to lead is actually a very perfect segue to the next question I wanted to ask. And I wanted to ask it to Tiare. And I'm thinking about what Dr. White just shared about just the sense of how many shoulders and how much legacy we all stand on. And thinking about the future of food justice, I thought I would ask you about that. I think you seem to be kind of the future in the process. And I am wondering that at your farm, I know that you grow both food and leaders. And that is something that you share. And I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit about what it's been like to learn to be a leader, what it's been like to learn that specifically on a farm. And I'd also love to know what direction you hope your leadership will take going forward.
Yeah. So I've been on MAʻO organic farms for 2 years now, but previously I've done a lot of the high school internships that they offer while we're in high school. And I've kind of done a lot of those internships, and then I found myself here right after I graduated. And I didn't think I would be here until now. Because, it was a platform for us. It was, we pay for your tuition and you work on the farm and you get, these benefits that they help us throughout school. But I've grown to love being on the farm, working on the farm, and the people that we work alongside. And there's so much mentorship that happens on this farm, which she's my, role model. Like, we only aspire to be the best that we can because of the people that push us to be better. And the things that they teach us is to, better ourselves, and then also doing is bettering our community. And I've never learned any of these things while I was in high school. And I can say that MAʻO has shaped the way I am, and the way I think towards, I want to better my education to help my family and myself, but also to better my community, we have a lot of struggles in our community here in Waianae. And, I want to continue to see where I can, my role here to set this foundation for the future, generations, not just myself, but a lot of the children that's being brought up in our community. I come from a big ohana, a big family, and I see where our food system's going. I see where our community is, and I want to do my part in making sure that they're not left with, a horrible food system and environment. But I think, I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, it absolutely does. And I can honestly feel your answer. It's really amazing. It's, it's easy to talk about all these things, but to really live them and learn them and enact them is a really big deal. And it sounds like that's what's happening there. Cheryse, can I ask you sort of a personal question? In this moment right now, when you've been told that, you're her role model, I mean, I'm very touched by hearing that. How does it feel for you? What does that mean to you?
It means a lot. She's gonna make me cry. I think for me, I grew up from a big ohana. So ohana is like our family. It's a Hawaiian term for family. And I come from a large family as well. And I'm actually the eldest sibling. So I think growing up, I think there's in Hawaiian understanding and Hawaiian practice and knowledge, like the hiʻako always kind of, the eldest sibling always kind of holds a lot of kuleana or responsibility. And I did that for my own personal family. And then when I came here, I kind of had that mentality, that just understanding, like, I needed to be the big sister. And I think my approach in like mentorship and leadership here has always tried to be a big sister. You know, and Tiare is not the first who's mentioned that to me. And like, I am so humbled to just be a part of like their journey, because I feel like they're constantly making me better. You know, they're making me into a better person, a better leader, and giving me the insight of like what I need to do to adjust myself and my healing and how I understand my role in making things better for our future generations. And keeping in mind that we always take care of our first mama, right? Our Aino, our land, our homeland, and understanding like our ancestors is why we are here. So always connecting, you know, I have a mentor that always said, we are only a moment between two eternities. So understanding like there is a past and the future, and always in every action you do, especially with food and with Malama Aina, you know, taking care of the land, you're keeping in mind the future and our and the past. And if to me, what I've learned in just working with young people all the time, and continuing the legacy here in Lu'ulele Valley, is that we keep those thoughts and we keep those people and the unknown in our practice, and we hope for the best, and you come with lots of good intentions, and you plan, but you plan with young people. You always plan with young people because they're who's gonna pick up the mess, or they're the ones who are gonna make it better. So I'm always humbled, and I feel touched to like kind of feel like I've been a part of their journey. For any young person here and any peer that I've had here, and even my mentors that I've experienced here, I think it's humbling to work with food, and it's humbling to work with land, and to be a part of that system, I think is super powerful.
Thank you so much. I feel like what the two of you just shared, you know, applies for so many fields, no pun intended, like whether you're farming or you're building or growing anything, right? You know, having that kind of relationship and, you know, is essential for the future. I'm wondering if you could share any, either of you, if you could share any logistics around the just communication you have. I imagine the communication is a huge part of the mentoring of just probably the farming that goes on a day-to-day basis. And are there ways in which you communicate or you take time aside to talk about certain things? Like, are there any logistic practices you would suggest to anyone else who's trying to really establish a meaningful kind of mentorship relationship?
Yeah, I mean, Tiare can speak if she has any manao, but I think a big practice that we have here that we've implemented from the beginning, every morning we start our day off with a chant or oli, Eho Mai. So Eho Mai for us, we do it as a group, whoever is scheduled for work that day. And in this practice, so some people might call it a pule or like a prayer. We call it Mai for like, boom. I'm using so much Hawaiian terms, so I'll try and keep up with it. But
I'm not fact checking.
Some people can do a prayer. We do a oli, so like a chant. And in this chant, we're asking permission from our land, from our ancestors, to continuously to learn. And we learn as an individual, and in our individual understanding, we can be helpful to the collective. And understanding that we can get all work done, and there are some things we don't know, but we must be open to it to be better. So that is one major practice that we do together. So in the beginning of the day, everyone comes together and we all do it. After that, there's two other main practices that we do on the farm. We have a check-in and a check-out. So whether if it's at 5 o'clock in the morning or at 7 o'clock in the morning or 9 o'clock in the morning, we do a check-in. So whenever the day starts, we do Eho Mai. And then after that, we do a check-in of announcements, of updates on fields and work. It could be about current events of what's happening in the world to make sure that we host a space for conversation. And then at the end of the day, when all the interns are here, there's about 48 of us, of the interns, the young interns, we have a checkout. And so at the checkout, we reserve 30 minutes of the ending of the workday. Everyone is paid for it and accounted hours, but it's more of a mentoring space and understanding like what people have learned, what youth have learned, if youth have questions. But it's also a safe space for us to ask hard questions, to be vulnerable. You know, people have shared personal stories, and it's an understanding of it's a shared space for us to know that it's a healing space. So we do those practices every day of the farm here. And some days it's rough, some days it's like enlightening and liberating. But that's a part of the dailiness that we all need. And I think having that kind of sort of reflection is important, and to continuously do it as a team, and not just only like a, maybe like a executive team, but a team that has the executive director and a first semester intern. I think it's super important to share those spaces, because not all knowledge is found in one school or one house. So leaving that space open for anything, and understanding that we have to be open is super critical, I think, in communicating goals and stuff.
Tiare, do you have anything to add to that? She's got it covered. I love hearing that. I think just I'm always very curious about, you know, we're talking about really big topics today, really important issues, and I'm always so curious about the logistics of how different teams and communities really just practice these things and make them happen. And hearing that you dedicate this daily time, you know, it's a practice like anything else, and it's very inspiring to hear. I feel like I want to build that into just my life as an individual, just even, you know, with my wife at the end of the day to have our checkout. I really like that. John, I want to switch over to you. And in thinking a little bit about what we just learned about the kind of like logistics of communication, I've been thinking about you and the work you do with Ghetto Gastro, because I've always been so inspired by the way you and your group, you guys connect so many dots in so many different ways with so many different people. And I think that this kind of practice, to me, it's about really reaching people exactly where they are, explaining things very clearly, creating some excitement around these things, and empowering people to kind of get really involved. So I'm wondering how you see the role of storytelling and various forms of media, including social media, in the fight for food justice. You know, how does it fit in just right alongside farming and these other things we're talking about?
Well, for the work we do with Ghetto Gastro, I think we always try to take the approach of meeting people where they are, and especially with the youth, and like really wanting to engage with youth. So it's like, if we're putting a message on a t-shirt that they're going to want to wear, it's like that might penetrate somebody in their friendship group, in their circle, when they're thinking about food as a weapon and how it might have been used in our neighborhoods through vehicles like food apartheid. But thinking about how can we re-engineer and reverse that to use food as a weapon for nourishment, to fight oppression, and to dismantle systemic issues that have kind of plagued our communities, have been inflicted upon our communities for centuries. So yeah, I think it's important for us to connect with the homies that have a little bit of influence and just start planting the seeds. Like, no pun intended, we take a soil to the oil. So it's like, you want to plant the seeds of info and water them and just let them grow, you know, because like everybody else said, the future's in the youth, you know, we're just custodians. So the knowledge is passed on, and I'm a sponge. Like, I'm learning. Like, I'm not an expert, you know, like on a panel, I'm learning every day, like new language, new histories that I just think it's my job to disseminate the information and get it to the people that need it.
You do it so powerfully. And I think even what you just explained and shared shows, to me at least, a remarkable kind of lack of ego. You know, it's not about you. It's about you learning and about you sharing. And is that something, I guess, one, do you agree with that? And two, is that something that comes naturally to you, or was that something you had to learn?
Well, I think I have a unique privilege of being able to sit in a few different worlds at one time. So I think it's necessary for me to share whatever insights I'm grabbing at these intersections and make sure they're dispersed. So whether it's like things I'm learning in the streets that people that have the power of the checkbook need to know and where to deploy their capital, or things that I'm learning from being on a panel with experts and great thinkers that I need to disseminate in the street or in the hood. It's like, I think it's, like I said, I'm just a vessel. It's just a conduit. And I think it's my responsibility to be able to use that privilege in a way that's resourceful and beneficial.
I'm with you. I will say it's definitely part of why I'm truly honored to get to just ask these questions and to have had the opportunity to prepare for this panel, to ask all of you these types of questions. I really identify with what you're saying. I want to talk a little bit about money and about the food system and capitalism. And a lot of the structural inequities that I think most of us are pretty aware of in the food system stem from capitalism. And Dr. White, I think you do such a phenomenal job of helping us understand the history of alternatives to capitalism. And I was wondering if you could tell us briefly about what history shows us about cooperative models and about mutual aid and the way these things not merely work, but the way that they can really create viable economies.
Sure. There were several organizations that I collected data that I don't describe in the book. So what I did was I kept, every time I read something about a cooperative or collective of Black farmers, I wanted to understand what is it that they did and how could we then understand all those activities. And I created a theoretical framework that I call collective agency and community resilience. The collective agency and community resilience is really a strategy or a way to sort of think about, the way to explain what we see happening in a lot of these organizations across time. So agency is often studied as a psychological construct, but what happens when a community of folks come together to make sure that everyone has access to nutrient-rich food? I think resilience is something that we've been talking about quite a while. It's how do we respond to catastrophic events? Most significantly, we'll be talking about that, as we sort of think about what happens after, whatever COVID is and whatever the ramifications are. But I think it's irresponsible to talk about resilience without talking about the structural forces that lead some communities more vulnerable than others. So that's why I talk about it in terms of collective agency and community resilience. Three strategies that when I collected all the different activities that collectives and cooperatives did over time, there were three things that I saw very clear as ways that these organizations were functioning. One is economic autonomy and recognizing that it's difficult to achieve economic autonomy, especially in a global market, but we can talk about the ways that organizations were interested in making sure that the money that they, whatever money they had access to or utilized was something that they were able to benefit from. And so that it was a way to talk and think about economics that would be regenerative and not extractive, but also, so some examples at D-Town, we've got D-Town dollars. So you spend a couple of hours, you get D-Town dollars, you turn those dollars in for the nutrient-rich foods that you've just grown. And so thinking about a different kind of an economic model, I have a former colleague who says, we shouldn't have a salary based on a set of criteria that are disconnected from folks. We should have an hour's worth of labor for an hour's worth of labor. In other words, my work as an academic, as an intellectual, isn't less important than a food producer, right? As a matter of fact, I would argue we need farmers more than we need folks to sort of talk and think about. So that's my own. But when we think about an hour's worth of labor worth an hour worth of labor, it doesn't place a value for some over others. Another strategy that we found that fit under collective agency and community resilience is commons as praxis. I heard earlier folks were talking about how do we make decisions about how to use the resources that we should, that we all share. If I do something to the water, that impacts the water that we all drink. If I do something to the air, to the earth, that impacts what we all have. And so we should all be involved in making these decisions. So when we talk and think about commons as praxis, that means that folks are collectively involved and engaged in not just the decisions that are made, but also reaping the benefits of that. And the last thing that I found was what we call prefigurative politics. So what we found, especially in the late 60s, and even before, you know, much longer, that African-Americans have been, disenfranchised from the right to vote. And so we see that folks within organizations, we're able to create a safe space, political education, so we can talk and think about the political opportunities that we have and the alternatives that exist within this environment. But even more than that, it is the exercise of hearing my voice count and matter within these organizations. And so that then creates the space for us to talk and think about the ways that this would happen outside of that. So I think that collective agency and community resilience, it just happens to be a theoretical framework that captures the history of these organizations and how they functioned.
I'm just sitting here nodding so much. You absolutely answered my question. You absolutely did, and I'm honestly grateful to the Smithsonian for recording this, so I could really just listen and I can watch this hopefully again and again, because there's so much in what you just shared, and it's all so important. And a word you mentioned earlier when defining food apartheid, you brought up the idea of what's deemed worthy, and I feel like so much of what you just described really centers on, this idea of worth, what things are worth, what labor is worth, what land, what food, what we are worth as people, and as a collective. So, I thank you for kind of further illuminating that word, giving us so much.
Crisis has us thinking differently about food, right? Mm-hmm. So we went to the shelves and the shelves were bare. And so people were like, how vulnerable are we? And I think that we were asking a lot of questions, especially in early quarantine, about, okay, well, this is a system that is based on injustice, right? Stolen land, stolen labor, and we don't pay the laborers the fair rate of what their labor is worth. Mm-hmm. And so given this reality, I'm hopeful that we will construct food systems that do honor, that do respect, and that do create the space for us to be equally involved in the kinds of conversations and the benefits of our collective space, our labor, and what have you. So I feel like there's a need for a different kind of conversation. And I see a lot of that happening in communities, and I'm hopeful mm-hmm. that will continue and will spread.
I definitely hope so. And I hope so much of what's happening right now, that the lessons learned will carry with us. Speaking of food systems that work better for the collective, that treat, the people who grow the food, who treat the earth that grows the food with dignity, and I think an idea of justice, it makes me think of the work that Cheryse and Tiare are doing. And I'm wondering if I can turn back to the two of you, just on this idea of money, really, of logistics, of how things work. Can you share a little bit with us about how the farm is sustained financially and how it works, how you're able to, in a capitalist American system, do the work that you're doing?
Yeah, I mean, so the farm is set up as a nonprofit social enterprise. Mm-hmm. So we have a nonprofit umbrella that we're under, and we have our program. So the program that Tiare was talking about, and I actually graduated through that program. So the farm actually is offers a 2-year internship The interns work on the farm part-time, and so they're in the production, a part of the production operations. It's an organic, certified organic farm, so they do everything from planting, harvesting, processing, to selling product at the farmer's market, talking with our co-producers in our community and on Oahu. For their sweat equity, they get a starting stipend, a monthly starting stipend at $525 a month. And they get a full tuition waiver at Leeward Community College, which is a community college underneath the University of Hawaii system here in Hawaii. So we have that as our social enterprise. So that is funded grants and fundraisers. The enterprise part was where I am mostly housed in now because of I've been on the farm for 13 years now. So I did the programs, did up here, got my AA, got my bachelor's in Hawaiian studies through the farm. I had scholarships throughout the whole way, and the farm paid for it. And the enterprise part is we run a certified organic farm. When I first came to the farm in 2007, we were only 5 acres. Now we're totaling at 281 acres. And we recently just purchased 256 acres in the last 2 years, all with ships of our co-producers, some of our educational partners, lots of people who really want to see this model grow. So Dr. White talks about a different kind of food system and a different type of model. Our founders had a big concern because we, in a traditional, you know, not only Hawaii, but Pacific kind of food system, there was no money involved. It was that you had kuleana, you had a role, you grew food, you learned how to catch fish, you learned how to, build hale or build a house, or you were a practitioner in holding knowledge, certain knowledges, and you had a role. But everyone's collective role was to keep the water clean, because that is everyone. So in our how the farms run, we do a lot of the programming, the educational program, but then the farm runs to be able to function by itself. So the revenue that we make on the farm provides my salary, provides all the pays for all the bills and the cost of production for our farm. Any extra revenue that we make, we actually funnel it back into programs for people like Tiare or young people like Tiare. So when they start in the program, their monthly stipends start at $525. But after their first semester, we pay them on a grade scale that averages out their school GPA and a farm GPA. So we have a grading evaluation that we do for the farm, and it's based on like not only knowledges and practices of what you do on the farm, but things like about, you know, how well does this person communicate? Mm-hmm. Or one thing is like leadership that we grade on, or another category is about entrepreneurship. You know, is this person, maybe they're not going to be the top salesman, but are they talking to customers that they never spoke to before? You know, how are they as a team member? You know, and some of the more than half of the evaluation is not about the knowledges of being an organic farmer, but it's just about being a good human being and how you interact in your community and with your peers. So that GPA from the farm and a GPA from their schoolwork, the aggregate of that is their pay scale. So if they get a 4.0 in school and maybe like a 3.5 on the farm, they get a higher pay average for their stipend. So maybe their first semester, because everyone's starting at the kind of same level, kind of just entering, their first semester it could be 525, but then their second semester it could be 575, you know. But it's based on their commitment and their performance. So maybe they got a 2.0 and a 2.0, you know, or a 2.0 and a 3.0. Maybe then their stipend becomes 550, you know. So we have these opportunities and incentives within the program so that young people feel empowered to do better, not because we're telling them, oh, you should get your degree or you should work harder. It's showing them like the work that you do, and you don't have to be the best. All we want to see is effort and growth. and you give a young person that, and you get young leaders like a Tiare. Mm-hmm. And there's so many of Tiares on the farm, and I'm so proud of them, like all of them. And to see their growth happen from, you know, one semester to the next, or 1 year to the next, these guys are I feel doing a lot more than a lot of other people that we're doing in the community. And it's just because they're doing their best and they have a support system to get there. So these guys, I feel, are rocking the food system, because not only are they getting an education and they're working on the farm, you know. So in our community, what we see is a lot of our young people leave the community to get an education and they don't do well. You know, mm-hmm. a lot of them come back home, they come back in debt, they come disappointed and discouraged because they didn't do well in the States or they didn't do well outside of Hawaii. And it's hard because it's, one, really expensive to live here, and they come back with debt. And, you know, it's like a shot to their confidence in themselves and to their family sometimes. So to have this system where we can challenge young people and understand, like, hey, you have a role, you know, and your kuleana, or your what you hold responsible to you in your role is important, not just for you, but the cohort after you, or the five cohorts after you, because you're just building onto this legacy that the farms has done for the past 20 years. I don't know. It's a lot.
No, you totally, I appreciate the answer and the detail too. I think it's so much, your response to that combined with Dr. White's response to that previous question, it's such a, just proactive lesson in how we value things and how we name their worth and compensate people for what they do and how they do it. And, it's amazing to hear. I appreciate it very much. I want to ask John a similar question about your work and Ghetto Gastro and the sort of kind of thinking about what Dr. White shared about, you know, these cooperative kind of systems and communities and how they work in a kind of economic way. You know, Ghetto Gastro, you guys do everything from selling like the coolest t-shirts to spices to, you know, events and different things. Like, you guys operate in so many different lanes, and I imagine that gives you a diversified kind of you know, different streams of revenue. And can you talk a little bit about just how the business is structured? And I've also heard you talk a little bit before at other events like this about the kind of Robin Hood model you guys do. You mentioned earlier about how you're able to kind of exist within different groups of people, and you can talk to the people who might have deeper pockets and stuff. And so could you talk a little bit just about money and how it all works and what is the economy of Ghetto Gastro?
Well, money for me, getting money, AKA getting to the bag, has always been one of my skills. Just starting from how I came up hustling in the streets, like, that was always a big part of liberation, you know, thinking about growing up in environments where you wanted to be able to have access to other things. You had to figure out how to get it how you live. But what I have learned is that money is just a tool, and it's not to be worshipped. And with our approach to capitalism, with the Robin Hood approach, or like mutual aid community economics, is really like, we created Ghetto Gastro, which is, I guess some would say, a luxury offering or a luxury brand. So we've been able to do projects and partner with different luxury brands like the Cartiers of the world in Paris. But then we keep those resources in the Bronx when we're thinking about the people that we hire, where we spend our money, like the people that we partner with in a community. So for us, it's really just about, a lot of it has to do with value and like what you were just saying with worth. When people look at like white supremacy versus blackness, like when you even think about the food system, and even if we go to restaurants or like cuisines that are noteworthy or people are comfortable spending lots of money on different types of Eurocentric cuisines, but then when they look at African Americans making food, it's usually, what type of collard greens are you making? What type of soul food are you making? But I think it's a lot more nuances, because you have the Afro-Caribbean, you have African, you know, African American, and this whole diaspora and the offering that comes from that. And what we want to do is like highly political, because it's like, yeah, we're selling cornbread for $100,000 and you got to love it. You know, it's like, so it's really, a lot of people measure their respect with their pocketbook. Like when they're like, oh yeah, I love the Mexican food. Let me go get a dollar taco. But it's like, I feel like a lot of times people treat how they value our food, how they value the people. Just like when you were talking about the different parts of the chain of food supply, from the farmers, the growers, different distributors, like the people that really are custodians of this land. So for us, it's a similar thing. And yeah, like we have influence, and we leverage that to feed people in our community. So like we've been doing that with La Mirada, which is a family-owned restaurant owned by undocumented immigrants. So they weren't eligible for any, I think it's PPT. We didn't get any either, but I think it's PPT or PTT, whatever it is. So they weren't eligible for any of that government assistance. So we leveraged a corporate client of ours to cut a big check to be able to work with Rethink and then get out close to 100,000 meals between the Bronx and San Francisco as a response to COVID. And it was about feeding people in the community that are often overlooked, whether it's the people in like the women's shelters or people that are recently released from being incarcerated at halfway houses. Like a lot of the times these folks are overlooked. Elders that are living in public housing and their elevators are broken so they can't get downstairs to get food. Like having people that are going to walk those 16 flights up Patterson houses to make sure these elders are fed and taken care of. So that's kind of really what the work is. And we're unapologetic about it, because it's like, yeah, that's how we're giving it up.
It's wonderful. And I think you guys show us what that can look like and by doing it, which is inspiring. I feel like the...
I also realized that we have to get more money, because I also don't want us to have to, what quarantine and the COVID showed me is that like so many people and so many businesses are vulnerable that, you know, I feel like we have to build our war chest, because I'd love in the next few years for us to just be able to deploy capital in our community and have our own mutual aid funds to support people and not have to make the call to a corporate client, you know? So mm-hmm. It's a whole new motivation, because we don't want to have to ask for permission. That's the whole goal.
I think that's, a bumper sticker to not have to ask for permission is a very, very worthy goal. And yeah, I just keep coming back to that word worth and worthy. And I think it's what you're all talking about today. And, to me very much defines food justice and why it matters. I wanted to close looking ahead to the future, which is, I think we're all in agreement, it's looking to the youth. And Cheryse, I appreciate what you said about there can't be any planning without including youth. So Tiare, if it's not too much pressure, I'd like to ask you the last question. Thinking ahead, pointing towards the youth, having you lead us. For anyone who's listening to this, who's at home, maybe like me, nodding over and over to everything all of you have shared and offered today, who's really like feeling this conversation and feels how important it is and gets that food justice not only matters, it's undeniable, but they're at a loss of what they're going to do. You know, what are their personal decisions? What's the next meal they're going to have after they listen to this conversation? Where are they going to shop for the ingredients? You know, these personal decisions we all get to make on a daily basis when it comes to the food system. So for someone who's feeling maybe a little bit inspired right now, but a little unsure about how to move forward, what do you say to that person? What advice would you give them?
Feeling unspired. Oh, sorry.
No, take your time. That's...
advice you would give somebody who's like in the air of like what to do next after listening to us talk?
I think if I was in this position, like unsure after this, I would really think about our world now and if we're going at the rate that it is, what would our future look like? Or rather than how, after watching this, how can all of this information impact you in a way that you're consciously thinking about your future generations that you might bring or already, you know, on their way to become in our places? And how can you kind of give them like the extra nudge of, you know, like to be better and to, like Kaui said, to fix the mess. I think I think it's for them to like really internally think about your purpose and your role in the world today and what would you want to do to make it look better. I really don't know how to like answer it.
What are you doing? Yeah. Or like, what are some things that you're doing to alleviate the pressures of tomorrow?
Well, okay. So for my personal experience, I'm a middle child, but I'm actually the current oldest in the house and the current oldest daughter. And I have plenty younger siblings and I have nieces and nephews. And what I'm doing, I'm thinking about their future. Like, I'm constantly thinking about their future. You know, because we are in the midway of our life, but I want to be able to be that role model that they can look towards, to follow in a path that's better than what was set for us, based off of our living lifestyles and our living situations. I'm constantly trying to learn more and improve myself so that I can show them that there's things better to do, more to our life. I guess that's what I'm doing for myself.
I think that's wonderful. And honestly, I appreciate that you didn't give us like three bullet points of like, go to this website, do this, you know, because it's deep internal work and it's a lifelong commitment, right? I think I see you showing us what that looks like. So thank you for holding up that mirror for all of us. I think that's really wonderful. I know I said that was the last question, but I would just like, before we close, just to take this opportunity, because I'm sure anyone who's listening feels as inspired by all of you as I do. If we could go around and you can let people know how they can best support your work, whether it's ordering a book or a product, or if there's someone you'd like them to learn more about or research or anything, if just the best ways people can support what you're doing and what you care about. So Dr. White, why don't we start with you? What's the best way for people to support your work and what's on your mind?
So the best way for people to support my work is to support the work of Black farmers, Black, Indigenous, Latinx farmers, right? And I love the work of Dr. Heber Brown. He doesn't just say, bring us the produce and we'll buy it, but he actually goes about providing the labor, the resources, the finances to make sure that farmers have what they need in order to put the seeds in the ground and to harvest and to do the work. So you can support me by supporting farmers. And if by chance there's any interest in buying the book, I would hope that you would support a Black, Latinx, or Indigenous bookseller. To me, it is really important that we, in order for us to, as was previously stated, to create the kind of system that we want to see, we have to really shift the way we spend our money and think about who we support when we vote with our dollars. So I think that those would be the two ways that I would encourage folks to support our work.
I thank you so much for both of those ideas. That's wonderful. John, what's the best way for anyone listening to support you and Ghetto Gastro and whatever is most meaningful to all of you right now?
I'm going to echo the doctor and add, just listen to Black women, you know, because they got the gems, all the jewels. And in terms of Ghetto Gastro Direct, like, just stay tuned to our social media. We're dropping things randomly, so you got to stay alert. And yeah, stay armed and dangerous. Like, you did meditate, keep your mind and your body and your soul connected, because it's a war out there.
Thank you, John. And Cheryse and Tiare, what's the best way for anyone to support what you guys are doing?
I would suggest kind of the same thing. Understand where you're, you know, maybe get educated of where your food is coming from to make better choices. If it's local, if it's organic, that'll be a plus. But knowing where your food comes from is super important. Because we do have the power in the decision making of where our dollar goes to and what we want to see in our food system. There is a lot to unpack, I guess, with our farm too, and you can check out our website. But I think for me, being part Native Hawaiian, if people ever are interested to come into Hawaii, I would kindly ask to get educated about the history of Hawaii. In terms of its food system, its occupation of land, the overthrow of our Hawaiian kingdom, because it would be really critical. It's really critical to understanding of where our native peoples are now and the struggles that we have. And, you know, from those struggles, there can come resilient programs and farms like MAʻO. And there are more popping up similar to us, and we want people to continue to support programs like us and others that are developing here in Hawaii.
I appreciate the call to educate ourselves. It's essential. I thank you all so much for your time today, for sharing everything you shared. It's generous, and it's very appreciated, at least personally by me, and I'm sure it will be by many. So thank you all so much. And I want to thank you for being part of Food History Weekend. And to learn more about everyone here and to learn more about food justice, I invite anyone listening to visit the resources tab on the website. There's more information there. There's more information everywhere. So go for it. Thank you all again. I really appreciate it.